So what you just saw was a rather tame version of what we're about to witness in the trumpet judgments as they continue. I just wanted you to know what a swarm of locusts looked like, and I thought that was an appropriate song to go with it. If you're just joining us, we are now deep into the horrendous events that will mark the period of history known as the Tribulation, a period of 7 years in which most of the world will be destroyed, and by the end, nearly all of humanity will be killed. And the purpose of this, great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equaled again, as Jesus called it, is none other than the promised salvation of the nation of Israel and the addition of many souls into heaven. But it also includes the promised justice for the wicked that the world has been waiting for. If you missed any of the last few weeks, you definitely need to catch up. So we've covered the wars and the famine of the first six seals, which of course killed off a fourth of the population and moved the mountains and islands out of place. The first four trumpets caused a third of the earth and trees to be burned up along with all of the green grass, followed by a giant meteor wiping out the Pacific Ocean and the surrounding land masses, killing a third of the sea life and a third of the ships and turning a third of the water into blood. Then another meteor called Wormwood disintegrates in the atmosphere and spreads poison all over the fresh water. And finally, the sun, moon, and stars develop short circuits and start flickering off during the middle of the day and middle of the night. Crazy. And just before we finished last week, John, the person who's writing this and seeing all these visions, saw an eagle flying around in the sky and yelling to the earth, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, because the trumpet blasts about to be sounded by the other three angels." In other words, if you thought all of that was bad, it's clearly about to get much worse. So let's pray before we continue. Lord, we love you. We do again ask for insight and wisdom as we see these horrendous events. Help us to understand the purpose behind all of these and to serve you better. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me into Revelation chapter 9. Revelation is at the very back of the book, chapter 9. And we'll see what happens next, starting in verse 1. The fifth angel sounded his trumpet, and I saw a star that had fallen from the sky to the earth. The star was given the key to the shaft of the abyss. When he opened the abyss, smoke rose from it like the smoke from a gigantic furnace. The sun and sky were darkened by the smoke from the abyss, and out of the smoke locusts came down on the earth and were given power like that of scorpions of the earth. And they were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any plant or tree, but only those people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were not allowed to kill them, but only to torture them for 5 months. And the agony they suffered was like that of the sting of a scorpion when it strikes. During those days, people will seek death, but will not find it, and they will long to die, but death will elude them. The locusts looked like horses prepared for battle. On their heads they wore something like gold crowns, and their faces resembled human faces. Their hair was like women's hair, and their teeth were like lion's teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was like the thundering of many horses and chariots rushing into battle. They had tails with stingers like scorpions, and in their tails they had the power to torment people for 5 months. They had as king over them the angel of the abyss, whose name is in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek is Apollyon, and that is destroyer. The first woe is past. Two other woes are yet to come. So there's a lot to talk about in this one. And I'll let you know now that there is no natural explanation for what just happened. Though many have tried to make there be one, I will let you read that junk on your own. Let's start back at the top. Verse 1. The fifth angel sounded his trumpet, and I saw a star that had fallen from the sky to the earth. The star was given the key to the shaft of the abyss. When he opened the abyss, smoke rose from it like the smoke from a gigantic furnace. The sun and sky were darkened by the smoke from the abyss. So let's talk about this star. And the third trumpet, the thing that fell to the earth, so this is the fifth trumpet, and then the third trumpet, the thing that fell to the earth, was also called a star, but we determined based on the other language in that part, and also that it was not a literal star like our sun, but it was also not an angel since it was distributed over the waters. Angels don't usually get distributed. So this star, however, is referenced to in verse 2 as a he, and it is also given a key that opens the shaft of the abyss, not things that inanimate objects usually do. So it's safe to assume that this star is a heavenly being, an angel. Also notice that this star is not described as falling, but as having already fallen. There are many opinions on who this angel is and when he fell, and some like to suggest that it's Satan himself, but that is not likely since Satan is never referred to as just an angel or a star. There are actually quite a few roles that people think that Satan plays in the end times. But if you take the text literally, it's really not as many as you think. It seems like that many of the other fallen angels are the ones that do the dirty work, and he's kind of just directing them. But mostly, the one doing the directing is not Satan, but God himself. Remember that God controls everything, even the fallen angels. They can only operate within the bounds he sets for them, and sometimes they are given specific jobs to do, even though they are fallen. Even Satan himself is not free to do whatever he wants, as we will see later. So, anyway, the angel is given a key to the shaft of the abyss. So who gave him the key? We don't know. It doesn't say. Let's talk about the abyss. The word abyss translates and comes from the Greek word abusos. Abusos. Say it with me. Abusos. Excellent. Which literally means without a bottom or a bottomless pit. We find a reference to it in the Gospels when Jesus encounters a demon-possessed man. Luke chapter 8. Starting in verse 26, is they, the disciples and Jesus, they sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across from the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stopped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torture me." For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "Legion," he replied, because many demons had gone into him. And they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. The abyss. So instead, Jesus sends them to a herd of pigs. They run off a cliff, upset the local people. So clearly, these demons know about the bottomless pit, and they did not want to go there. They don't want to go there. Later in Revelation, we will see that the beast slash Antichrist actually comes from said pit. And even later, we will see that Satan himself is locked up in this pit or abyss for 1,000 years during Christ's reign on earth. Apparently, right now, as we speak, there are countless of these locust demons trapped down there just waiting to be released in the abyss. So where is this bottomless pit exactly? Well, this is one is probably going to make you scratch your head a bit. And you might not believe me at first because we've all been brainwashed by the modern science into believing that their imaginative guesses are proven facts. But there really is no reason to believe that the abyss is not literally inside of this planet. Hades too, for that matter. One indication here is that this angel opens a shaft to the abyss from the surface of the earth. As in a long tunnel through the earth to the abyss, and a bunch of smoke comes out, similar to a volcano. Now, I'm sure you've seen the diagrams of what is inside of the earth, and stars and other parts. Can you bring out that picture? But in truth, mankind has never drilled more than a mile or two into the surface of the earth, which literally doesn't even really scratch the surface, much less break through the so-called crust, which is the outer layer. And of course, we've never actually seen inside of a star or other planet or moon. In truth, all that talk about layers and the hot core is just theory. Or rather, hypothesis, mostly based on the assumption that the planet must have been formed by some random rock cooling down, which itself was formed by some random explosion from some nothing into something, which apparently made a big bang, but in reality, we don't know. And the fact that Hades and the abyss are usually referred to in Scripture as being in the earth and under the earth, why should we assume that they are not? Lest we forget that in the beginning, the earth was actually created before the sun and the moon and the stars. You read your Genesis account, the earth came first. Modern science likes to make planet Earth seem insignificant among the billions and zillions of stars, but according to God, we, planet Earth and humanity, actually are the center of the universe. Maybe not physically, but in manner of significance. Because not only did God make the earth before the stars and create human beings in his own image, God sent his own son to this planet to become human so to save us from ourselves. The world tries to make you think you are an accident on top of a few other billion accidents, but God created this planet and you specifically and intentionally, and he knows every hair on your head or even lack of hair on your head. It actually makes perfect sense when you think about it that way, that heaven literally is above us in the sky, though hidden, and that hell is literally below us inside the earth, and we are in the middle, headed for one or the other. Anyway, that should give you something to think about. Now let's talk about these demon locusts. Revelation 9, back to verse 3. It says, out of the smoke, locusts came down on the earth and were given power like that of scorpions of the earth. They were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any plant or tree, but only those people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were not allowed to kill them, but only to torture them for 5 months. And the agony they suffered was like that of the sting of a scorpion when it strikes. During those days, people will seek death, but will not find it. They will long to die, but death will elude them. So a giant plume of smoke fills the sky, darkening the sun, or at least what's left of it, right? And out of the smoke comes what John can only describe as this swarm of locusts. After the video we watched, you can kind of imagine what that might look like. Just millions of them, right? There are probably billions of these descending on the earth. It looks like a swarm of locusts, but they are not normal locusts by any stretch. Several artists have attempted to depict these creatures. You can go to the next one. Yeah, so here's some of the artist's renditions of these creatures. Let's see if how they get it. Revelation 9, starting in verse 7. You can keep this picture on the screen. It says, the locusts look like horses prepared for battle. On their heads they wore something like crowns of gold, and their faces resembled human faces. Their hair was like women's hair, and their teeth were like lion's teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was like the thundering of many horses and chariots rushing into battle. They had tails with stingers like scorpions, and their tails had power to torment people for 5 months. I like the one on the left the best. I think that one's probably the best one. Another interesting fact about these locust demons, they apparently have a king over them. It says in verse 11, it says they had a king over them, the angel of the abyss, whose name in Hebrew is Abaddon and in Greek is Apollyon. That might be what he looks like. I don't know. So anyway, not much is known about this guy, this demon, this angel. Doesn't sound like a very nice guy, though. But more important than what they look like and what kind of king they have over them is what they do and what they cannot do. First, they have power like scorpions to sting and torture people, which normal locusts don't do. They are also told not to harm the plants, the grass, or the trees, which is exactly what normal locusts actually do. So clearly, these are not anything from our world, but a horde of specialized demons that have one purpose, to torture the people of Earth for 5 months, but not all the people of the Earth. The text says that they are only allowed to attack one group of people, those who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Now this should immediately make you think of the 144,000 who were sealed a couple of chapters ago by God. So that would be one group of people who are not affected, but many argue that this seal of God will also be on anyone who is a believer at this time. There are a couple of references to this that point in this direction. One is later in the very end of the book in chapter 22. It says, then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. So did you catch that? The servants of God will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need light of a lamp or light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. So this indicates that at some point, all those who make it to the new heaven and the new earth will have the same name of God on their foreheads, which is exactly the same seal that the 144,000 had. So it's possible that those who are saved through their efforts get the same seal and thus are not affected by these judgments, which also makes sense since believers are not appointed to wrath. Seems like this would be a rather good foot in the door for the evangelists as they're going around trying to turn people to Christ, wouldn't you think? Other evidence of this view comes from the Old Testament prophet Ezekiel, who has a vision about something soon to happen to Israel at his time, which carries similar connotations. Let's read it together. Ezekiel 9, starting in verse 1. It says, "Then I heard him call out in a loud voice, 'Bring near,'" so he's talking about God, "'bring near those who are appointed to execute judgment on the city, each with a weapon in his hand. And I saw six men coming from the direction of the upper gate, which faces north, each with a deadly weapon in his hand. And with them was a man clothed in linen, who had a writing kit at his side. They came in and stood beside the bronze altar. Now the glory of God of Israel went up from above the cherubim, where it had been, and moved to the threshold of the temple. Then the Lord called to the man clothed in linen, who had the writing kit at his side. He said to him, 'Go throughout the city of Jerusalem, and put a mark on the foreheads of those who grieve and lament over all the detestable things that are done in it.' As I listened, he said to the others, 'Follow him through the city and kill, without showing pity or compassion. Slaughter the old men, the young men and women, the mothers and children, but do not touch anyone who has the mark. Begin at my sanctuary.'" So if you read the rest of that chapter at the beginning, basically they were doing some very awful things and God was tired of it. And he said, but there are still some in the city who actually do, they serve me, and they're not doing the things that the evil people are doing. Put a mark on their forehead, and as you go through and slaughter all these wicked people, don't kill them. And that's exactly what they did. And so it seems plausible that during the time that we're talking about with the demon locust, that those who are serving God, those who fear God, those who have Christ as their Savior, will have a mark on their forehead and thus not be tortured by these locust demons. So either way, it's not a good situation to be in. And there's more. I've already established that we believe that they will only be able to target non-believers. In addition to this, they are limited in that they are not allowed to kill anyone, just torture them for 5 months. Read it again, verse 5. It says, "They are not allowed to kill them, but only to torture them for 5 months. And the agony they suffered was like that of the sting of a scorpion when it strikes. During those days, people will seek death, but will not find it. They will long to die, but death will elude them." So I've heard that a scorpion sting is nothing to laugh at. I'm sure it will be quite painful, apparently to the point that the afflicted are trying to kill themselves in order to end it, but they won't be able to. Now, how that works, I don't know. Perhaps they'll be in so much pain that basically they'll be able to desire it, but they can't act on it because they're in so much pain and they're maybe like bent up. Maybe some have said that maybe the demons themselves that are torturing them prevent them from being able to kill themselves. Maybe it'll be like the movie Groundhog Day, where no matter what they do, they wake up the next morning and they're still alive. Or maybe they'll be like zombies. I don't know. We know that all we know is that for 5 solid months, no one will be going to hell. Did you ever think of it that way? Because they are not allowed to die, they won't be going to hell for their unbelief. Which means that a judgment like this is not spiteful, it's merciful. It is because of God's wonderful grace that he's going to give the unbelieving world a little taste of what hell is really like and not let them die in the process, in hopes that some of them will surrender. And the 5 month period is not arbitrary. 5 is the number of grace. Remember that that is what this is all about. Imagine it. This will be the only time in human history after people started dying that no one will go to hell for a period of 5 solid months. Did you know that right now, the average amount, on average, about 152,000 people in the world die each day? About 152,000 people die each day. Over the course of 5 months or 150 days, that totals 22.8 million people whose life comes to an end. And of course, that statistic does not include all the babies that are aborted and killed before they get a chance to live, but I believe they go straight to heaven, so we won't include them. So of the 22.8 million people that actually get to live past birth and get to choose their king, statistics show that only about 20 to 30% of those choose Jesus. Which means that right now, in a 5 month span, an average of 4.5 million people go to hell, or 30,000 every single day. That should break your heart. It sure breaks God's heart, which is why he's going to do something drastic to get the world's attention and even shut the doors of hell for 5 months so that stubborn man has yet another chance to make the right choice. That is grace. That is mercy. That is love. You see, God is such a loving God that he refuses to change your will for you. He will not turn you into a robot. He refuses to do your thoughts for you. He lets us have our way. But that doesn't stop him from trying everything to convince us to change. But God does have his limits. Moving on. Verse 12 says, the first woe is past. Two other woes are yet to come. So after 5 months of all this torture, the gates of hell are reopened. Pick it up in verse 13 of chapter 9. It says, the sixth angel sounded his trumpet, and I heard a voice coming from the four horns of the golden altar that is before God. It said to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, release the four angels who were bound at the great river Euphrates. And the four angels who had been kept ready for this very day, very hour and day and month and year, were released to kill a third of mankind. The number of the amounted troops was twice 10,000 times 10,000. That's 200 million. I heard their number. The horses and riders I saw in my vision looked like this. Their breastplates were fiery red, dark blue, and yellow as sulfur. The heads of the horses resembled the heads of lions, and out of their mouth came fire, smoke, and sulfur. A third of mankind was killed by the three plagues of fire, smoke, and sulfur that came out of their mouths. The power of the horses was in their mouths and in their tails, for their tails were like snakes, having heads with which to inflict injury. You know, when you read something like that, it's really hard to imagine it. You'd almost actually rather not. Another one-third of mankind killed. That plus the obvious deaths that must have happened during the previous trumpets, and the population of the earth is now below half of what it will be before the rapture. And probably would not be a stretch to say that it's actually down to about a fourth if you consider the wiping out of the Americas and all of the various plagues that don't mention a death count. So we're looking at maybe down to about 2 billion people total, isolated on the continents of Asia and Europe and Africa. So let's take a closer look at the details. So the sixth angel blows his trumpet, and he is told to release the four angels who are bound at the river Euphrates. Now the river Euphrates is a prominent river in the story of the Bible from beginning to end. It was near the Euphrates that sin began. The first lie was told. The first murder was committed. The Tower of Babel, which is the origin of an entire complex of false religions that spread across the world, that's where the Tower of Babel was built. The Euphrates was the eastern boundary of the Promised Land, Israel. And Israel's influence extended to the Euphrates River during the reigns of David and Solomon. The region near the Euphrates was the central location of three world powers that oppressed Israel, Assyria, Babylon, and Medo-Persia. It was on the banks of the Euphrates that Israel endured 70 long, bitter, wearisome years of captivity, and it is over this river which the enemies of God will cross to engage in the Battle of Armageddon at the end. So again, with this death-dealing army originating from this location, it lends more credence to the understanding that this area of the world will be the last one standing when all is said and done and the final battle is fought before the millennium reign. And they even call this area the Fertile Crescent. Basically, everything's centered around this river, effectively. And apparently, these four angels have been kept there, likely since the creation of the world, for this very hour. Now, who these angels are and how they got there, we don't know. It's really not worth speculating because it's not their identity that is important, but what they do, right? The text says that they were held there for this very hour and day and month and year. Now, we often hear these terms of time in Scripture, and especially in prophecy. Sometimes they are literal, and sometimes they are more relative in meaning. For instance, the day of the Lord actually encompasses the whole 7 years of tribulation, which is a rather short period of time in comparison to the history of the world, but still clearly longer than a literal day, correct? Also, the term hour can be used to indicate a relatively even shorter period of time. Later in Revelation, we will see that the 10 kings hold power over the earth for 1 hour before giving the power to the beast. This is to indicate a brief period of time, as in only part of the 7 years of tribulation rather than a literal 60-minute hour. And also, Jesus used the same term when he was being arrested at the Garden of Gethsemane. He says in Luke 22:53, this is your hour when darkness reigns. And clearly his trial and crucifixion took longer than an hour. So again, these times can be relative. So how do we know when the text is referring to a literal versus a relative day or hour? Well, you look at the context for clues. For example, in the case of the 7 days of creation, which many, of course, try to claim are not literal days, the context describes the day as being an evening and a morning. That, to me, sounds like the same kind of literal days that I experience about every 24 hours. If the phrase evening and morning had been left out of the description, it would be reasonable to assume that the day could have been just about any amount of time. But if you take the plain sense of the text, it's hard to argue for anything other than a literal 24-hour day that has an evening and a morning, just like today, unless, of course, you're trying very hard to match up the godless version of the history of the world with God's account, which can't be done. Now, I encourage you, if you haven't been with us for that long, to go on our website, look up a series that I did almost 2 years ago now called In the Beginning, and you can get the full scoop on how the Big Bang and the creation account in Genesis do not work together. Okay? Check it out. So the reference here in the sixth trumpet is similar to the one in the creation account in that the context gives us clues to whether it is a literal or relative time frame. It doesn't just say these angels are reserved for this hour and stop, as in this brief period of time. It goes on to specify this very hour, this very day, on this very month, and this very year. So the redundancy there is indicate that this is indeed a very specific and fixed point in the history of time, currently only known to God. Now, how they were bound there and why, we do not know, but they clearly have one specific purpose, and that is to kill a third of mankind with an army of apparently 200 million demon soldiers on horses with lions' heads and snake tails that breathe fire, smoke, and sulfur. Now, some try to suggest that these are human soldiers, likely from China, which, of course, is the only country with enough people to field that kind of an army, but I'm not sure if these kinds of horses are in China just yet. Maybe with, you know, some selective breeding, they can make it happen. And that's, of course, assuming they survive the giant meteor that lands in the Pacific Ocean, which they border. And, of course, that they decided to camp out at the Euphrates River, which is nowhere near China, all during the five-month plague of the demon locusts. You can go that route if you want. I'm just going to stick with literal interpretation of Scripture and say that these are demons. If you witness this later on, and I was wrong, I'm sorry. Either way, rather terrifying stuff. And once again, this very thing is also described in an Old Testament prophecy. It's not only found in Revelation, and it actually has a bit more detail. It's actually possible this prophecy in Joel combines the fifth and the sixth seals. There's certain things that can apply equally to both. We're going to read it, and you can decide. Joel chapter 2. It says, "Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm in my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness, like dawn spreading across the mountains, a large and mighty army comes, such as never was in ancient times, nor ever will be in ages to come. Before them fire devours, behind them a flame blazes, before them the land is like the Garden of Eden, behind them a desert waste. Nothing escapes them. They have the appearance of horses. They gallop along like cavalry, with a noise like that of chariots. They leap over the mountains like a crackling fire, consuming stubble, like a mighty army drawn up for battle. At the sight of them, nations are in anguish. Every face turns pale. They charge like warriors. They scale walls like soldiers. They all march in a line, not swerving from their course. They do not jostle each other. Each marches straight ahead. They plunge through defenses without breaking ranks. They rush upon the city. They run along the wall. They climb into the houses like thieves. They enter through the windows. Before them, the earth shakes. The heavens tremble. The sun and moon are darkened. The stars no longer shine. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty is the army that obeys his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it?" Indeed, who can endure it? Well, the answer is not many. But even in the midst of this terrible and righteous judgment on mankind that has shaken their fist at God, he still offers them a chance of redemption. Joel continues, verse 12. He says, "Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all of your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. And he relents from sending calamity." Who knows? He may turn and relent and even leave a blessing behind. Again, the purpose of all these judgments are twofold. One is we deserve it. Covered that last week. Two, God is still extending his hand to those who are tired of resisting, and he will forgive them. But despite the extended hand, and despite the clear proof that all of this is true, the truth of the Bible and God and creation and that the world has tried so hard to deny, despite being forced to see the truth and even given a taste of the consequences for refusal, the total depravity of man still holds more tightly to the lie. The end of the chapter, Revelation 9, verse 20, it says, "The rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues still did not repent of the work of their hands. They did not stop worshiping demons and idols of gold, silver, bronze, stone, and wood, idols that cannot see or hear or walk. Nor did they repent of their murders, their magic arts, their sexual immorality, or their thefts. It's like the proverb says, Proverbs 27:22 says, you cannot separate fools from their foolishness, even though you grind them like grain with mortar and pestle. In case you don't know what those are, I had to find a picture of it. I had to look it up. Anyway, as I've always taught, a fool is not someone who doesn't know better. A fool is not someone who doesn't know right from wrong. A fool is someone who knows absolutely what the right thing to do but says, no, thank you, I'm going to do the wrong thing. That's what a fool is. At this point in the tribulation, pretty near the midpoint, the remainder of mankind that is still alive are like that fool. They know the truth, but they reject it wholesale. And this kind of hatred of the truth is really not beyond imagination, right? Because we see the exact same thing happening today in the news. Seriously? All right. I can be like those charismatic preachers. They always like to use handheld microphones. Where was I? All right. So we've got this place. We're in this place now. We're at the end of all of this. All of this craziness, all of this death and destruction, the people who are still alive still shake their fist at God and say, I don't want you. And this kind of hatred of the truth is really not beyond imagination because we see the exact same thing happening today in the news. Just look at the abortion debate. Despite clear scientific evidence, visual evidence, and just plain common sense that a baby is a person before it is born, in America alone, we have murdered 58 million babies under the preferred lie, well, they're just not people yet. But even Horton the elephant knows that a person is a person, no matter how small. God's judgment is just. Now, the way this is worded often causes us modern people to dismiss it as, you know, not something we would ever really do. After all, we're all past the whole worshiping little statues of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, right? Especially here in America. Or are we? You know, actually, ours are mostly made of cheap metals, plastic, glass, and silicone. Bring up the next picture. The next one. That one. There we go. It's true that in our current Western culture, this kind of idol worship is rather foreign to us, mainly because we're far too busy worshiping ourselves to ever pay homage to anything else, including God himself. But rest assured that by this time in human history, the time we're looking at in the future, we will be right back to where we have been for most of human history, and especially during the ancient model of modern civilization, Rome. Rome. For all their sophistication, magnificent architecture, government structures, military power, art, poetry, and power, they were a society filled with the literal worship of idols, statues, big and small, of gods and goddesses. Their entire culture revolved around it. Every public place or event included some kind of paying homage to whatever god was at that location. And do you really think that humanity has outgrown that? Just because we have new toys? You see, once we are stripped of most of our modern technologies, which will kind of happen during this process, once we're stripped of these modern technologies that we pretend like we're not worshiping, you know, even though we quite literally bow to them, right, and work our schedules around them, and freak out if they're more than arm's length from us. But once we're stripped of those, and the world is left without the restraining of the Holy Spirit, we will certainly revert back to what humanity has done for most of human history, and worship idols made of gold and silver and bronze and stone and that we fashioned with our own hands. Because after all, at the heart of idolatry is the worship of self over God. Think about it. Why did the ancients worship these false gods? Basically, they attributed all of the things that the real God provides with being provided by something or someone else. Their worship was always based on what the god or goddess could be provide for them. In other words, it was selfish worship. It wasn't worship for the sake of glorifying said God because he deserves it, but for the sake of appeasing and even manipulating said God to give me what I want. Just as we read in Romans 1 last week, verse 21, it says, for although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave him thanks, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles. Notice, they did not give glory or thanks to God, who is the actual provider, but instead chose to worship the created thing rather than the creator. And we do the same thing in our culture, it's just not in the same way. Today, we still pay homage and worship, and perhaps a better way to say this is devote time and attention to the things we see as our providers. Providers of money, providers of food, providers especially of pleasure and entertainment and joy and so on, and happiness. We don't exactly bow down and worship these things, but we do spend most of our time and attention seeking what we need from these things rather than from the one who said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all of these things will be added to you. You know, I've spoken on this many times because I believe it is the greatest lie that so many believers fall prey to. And it's not a lie that you've been told from the outside. It's actually a lie that we tell ourselves, and we believe it. Most people who call themselves Christians would say that they really do seek the kingdom of God first, that God is first place in their life, that they truly do strive to follow the command to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And they really mean it because they can feel it deep down in their heart. But you see, seeking is not a matter of feeling. Seeking is a matter of doing. It's like my three-year-old who really wants to find his shoes. And he goes about looking for them by laying on the floor crying. And if you ask him, well, why don't you look for your shoes? He says, I am! Clearly, he's not going to get them anytime soon, is he? And likewise, so many believers think that wanting to seek the kingdom first is all that's needed. And they're disappointed when they can't seem to actually make any progress in finding it. Basically, if you want to know how your seeking of the kingdom is actually going, if you want to know how you're really doing, not just how you're feeling and what you think you're doing, how you're really doing, a quick look at your calendar and your checkbook will answer that question. Because what you spend your time on and what you spend your money on tells the story of what you truly set your heart on. Jesus said it best, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Romans 1:12:1 makes it clear that our true and proper worship is to present our bodies as living sacrifices. If your body, which includes your brain, is a living sacrifice, what that means is you are putting all of yourself at the disposal of the king. It means that your whole life is consumed with a passion to know and follow your Savior. And if that is your all-consuming passion, then it will most definitely show up in what you spend your time and money on. If most of your time and money are spent on the things that you seek to please yourself, then guess what you are actually seeking. Now, with that said, let me make it clear, I'm not suggesting that every person who is a Christian should give up their life and live as a monk secluded from the rest of society and reciting scripture all day, and that's all you should do. That's not what God wants from us, even though there was a whole monastic movement in the Middle Ages where a lot of people actually did that. No, God does not want us to take ourselves out of the world, because then how could we be the salt? How could we be the light that he called us to be? Instead, I'm referring to your disposable money and time. God understands that we have to work to feed our families. In fact, Scripture is clear that if you don't work, you don't eat. He understands we have bills to pay and certain familial and employment obligations, and you should be responsible in taking care of those and doing all those things as according to the Lord, right? We're even told in Scripture to pay taxes. But once your obligations are taken care of and you have choices of what to do with what's left, that's when your true heart shows itself. What do you spend your disposable money on? What do you spend your free time on? Tending to your kingdom or seeking his kingdom and building his kingdom? The answer to that will tell you if you have an idolatry problem or not. And if you find that you do, don't worry. Our Lord and King is all about changing lives, isn't he? In fact, that is the vision of Reality Church, to see lives changed by the transforming, restoring power of Jesus Christ. It's not just a catchy phrase. This is what our Lord and Savior does. If you're willing to just say, you know what, I keep trying it my way. I recognize, Pastor, that I got all these things that I'm worshiping, things that I'm seeking instead of the Lord. What do I do? Well, just ask him for help. He will change you. And if you need some more guidance, you can always talk to me and I'll help you out. All right. As for now, that wraps up the events of the first half of Tribulation. As far as my timeline is concerned, can you bring that up again? That timeline, there we go. So far we've covered everything from the first half of Tribulation. Next week, I'm going to get into all of the things that are covered in the middle of Tribulation, which actually covers chapters 10 through 14. So it's a bunch of chapters. So far, we've been kind of going linear, one thing right after another. They're sort of in order and chronology, or there's a whole lot of stuff that happens at the middle of the tribulation. It's not just that the Antichrist sets up the abomination that causes desolation. There's a lot of other things that go into that. It's very complex, very chaotic, and the don't miss them, okay? I'm really looking forward to giving these messages. We're going to get a little bit past some of the really doom and gloom and really bad stuff that we've been reading. The world really has gone through all of this stuff in the first 3.5 years of tribulation. It is a bad place to be, but now we're going to get into some more interesting things that probably don't make us cry, okay? And so I hope you will join us next week. I also hope that you'll stick around for the potluck today. And with that, let's pray, okay? Lord, we love you. I thank you for technology, even when it doesn't work. And I thank you that you are a God who wants us to know the truth, that you're a God who will go to all lengths to bring at least one more person to know you, even if it means to destroy most of the world and kill off half the world's population. It's hard for us to fathom, God. It's hard for us to comprehend how that is a good thing. But if we just help us to recognize that the moment we sin, we all deserve death. That it is only your mercy that any of us, not just 2/3, but any of us, are allowed to live at all. Help us to recognize that. Help us to see that we deserve every bit of it, but yet your mercy and your grace and your love for us to send your own son to this planet, to live among us, and to allow us to beat him to death and hang him on a cross and then die for us, that it's mercy, that it's love, that it's grace. Help us to trust you in that and serve you with our whole lives. And we give you praise and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen.